The young men in these photographs volunteered to serve as soldiers at the beginning of the First World War. They left their factories, offices and farms to fight in the battles of the Somme and Passchendaele. Remarkably, they survived and have lived to be more than 100 years old. Some of their stories have not been told for over 80 years. This is their account of an event in British history now almost beyond living memory. They are the last survivors of the Great War, the veterans.
I went along this road and a shell came along, and my goodness, it got louder and louder and louder, and I thought, my God, it's got my name on it.
One of the great big shells blew all the earth and the dirt straight on top of us. I couldn't move. I was terribly quickly breathing, gasping as it were, trying to get air in, of course. And it was only the fact that I'd got my steel hat on that saved my life.
Ah, yet that bit of luck with you, else it's no damn good. Look and sense. No good saying, oh, I'm a British soldier, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. You had to use your damn brains.
At 11 a.m. on a bank holiday Monday on the 4th of August 1914, Britons received the news that they were at war with Germany, a country with a vast army of trained reserves and conscripts. In contrast, Britain had only a small professional army, despite the size of its empire. As the British Expeditionary Force was rapidly dispatched to Belgium to meet the advancing enemy, the Secretary of State for War, Lord Kitchener, mounted a campaign throughout Britain to recruit 1 million volunteers. Amongst the first to volunteer in September 1914 was Dick Barron, a junior travel agent with Thomas Cook in London. He is now 103.
You can't imagine the war fever in those days, the patriotic war fever. I mean, we were at school told the thin red line. The soldiers were very, very spectacular creatures. And how they fought in the Crimea and the wonderful charge of the Light Brigade. It was all very romantic.
Robbie Burns grew up in the Scottish village of Gourock and was a 19-year-old clerk working in Glasgow. He is now 102.
Everywhere you went in Glasgow, the great big posters up of Kitchener with his finger pointing at you. No matter where you were, this finger seemed to be pointing at your king and country need you. However, I worked in an insurance office and I went to the window. I could see probably 200 or 300 men, and the pipes always seemed to do something to rouse my enthusiasm. I thought to myself, well, I want to do something like this.
More than 500,000 men were recruited in the September and October of 1914. Another was Jack Rogers, an apprentice shoemaker in his father's business in Hammersmith. He is now 104.
I was keen to go. I thought I'd like to be a soldier, you know, and do a bit of shooting. I was fancying being a rifleman. That was the point. And when I went up to Shepherd's Bush, which was the recruiting depot, they gave me then the choice of three different regiments I could have been in. The third one was the old Sherwood Foresters, 7th Battalion, and they were called the Robin Hood Rifles. So I fancied that, and I thought, oh, I'd like to be a Robin Hood Rifle.
To enlist, volunteers had to be aged between 19 and 38. But such was the determination of younger boys to join up, many lied about their age. Most recruiting officers turned a blind eye if the boys were strong and healthy. George Louth, a worker with the Portsmouth Gas and Coke Company, had lied about his age to get into the 15th Hampshire Regiment.
A colonel came round to visit us, to size us up, more or less, to see what we got. And he came round and asked questions. He said, and he asked each one how old they were and such like. So he came to me and asked me how old I was. I said, 19, sir. He said, 19? Yes, sir. Right. He went to the next man. He spoke to him. He come back to me again. He said, how old do you say you were? I said, 19, sir. And he looked at me straight. Now, I was only 18. I put my age on. And he walked away. And from then on, it was all go.
The raw recruits had to be rapidly turned into soldiers ready for battle. They would be trained at hundreds of makeshift army camps that sprung up all over Britain.
You had to learn how to use a gun. You used to go on musketry courses. And so I got to be, as it happened, quite a good shot. And I became eventually what they called a marksman. And so for which I got an extra sixpence a day on my wages.
The cavalry was the army's elite attacking force, and its training methods were renowned for their toughness and precision. Many thousands of grooms and delivery boys who worked with horses enlisted, but they still had much to learn to make the grade. Smiler Marshall, a former groom in Wivenhoe, was just 17 when he joined the Essex Yeomanry. He is now 101.
When we went to the 20th Hussars at Colchester, you have to ride all different horses, nothing on them, no saddle, no bridle, no nothing. You have to have a stick and a little cane under each arm, and then when the riding masters cracked the whip, he didn't say anything. He just cracked the whip, and the horses, all the horses that you were on, stopped dead. And you sure, if you didn't sit tight, I never come off. I'd sit there, but I'd put my arms round his neck. There, I knew, but half of them fell off. And the sergeant major shouted, "Who the hell told you to dismount?"
The biggest challenge for the civilian volunteers was army discipline. The training sergeants could be brutal in their demand for absolute obedience to authority. Humiliation was one of their weapons.
This particular sergeant, he got a nasty wagging tongue, and he used to call us all "you flippin' little mother's boys" and all that sort of talk, you know what I mean. And they always say they got one for him ready. They got a bullet ready for him any time. And they get a chance, he'll have one up the spout. It was quite true, too. I believe they would, in a sense. Some of them, they so disliked this one particular sergeant.
Sometimes the humiliation proved too much for young men like George Littlefair, a farm labourer before joining up.
There was one little bugger. Wax tash turned up and yapping and shouting, "You're not only your mother's aprons now," and all that bloody tittle tattle. And he used to call me Liquor Fair because he was short toned, he couldn't get Little Fair. And I was in one of them good humours, I never answered him. And so he come up and Timmer. He looked at him. "Who the hell do you think you are?" And I just stood. He said, "I think you're a bastard." Ooh, as soon as he said that, I hit him in the mouth with that. No, I said, "Don't prove it."
The incident was overlooked after it was discovered George Littlefair's mother had recently died. Norman Collins from Hartlepool had enlisted at the age of 18 into the Seaforth Highlanders, a regiment renowned for its fighting spirit.
I knew a little about the history of the Sea Force, and I liked their regimental tartan, and I was proud to be what you call a patriot, and a volunteer who was willing to defend his country and willing to die for his country. We were thrilled, and we were ready to do what was necessary to push the Germans back into Germany. We were determined to do that.
Well, we wanted to fight the Germans anyway. We couldn't let the Germans get away with that blinking old Kaiser and his son. We used to hate them people. But we certainly wanted to, you know, get out and do our bit because we thought they might be taken over here, you see.
The poets since the war began have written lots of things.
As the troops marched off to war, there was a carnival atmosphere. Here We Are Again was the big hit of 1914, especially popular with the troops.
Tommy likes a tricky song, the song that goes like this. Here we are, here we are, here we are again. There's Pat and Mac and Tommy and Jack and Joe. When there's trouble brewing, when there's something doing, are we downhearted? No, let them all come. Here we are, here we are.
We embarked on all our stuff. And before we were about to start, something happened which I shall never forget. The whole of the ship's company, from the top deck right down, including ourselves, suddenly burst into song in unison. Homeland. Homeland, when shall I see you again? Land of my birth, dearest place on earth, I'm leaving you. Oh, it may be for years, and it may be forever. Homeland, homeland. Up to then, the whole thing had been most enjoyable, but my heart stood still. I suddenly realized that this was a warfare. I may not return.
The civilian army was marching towards the front line, the Western Front, which stretched 400 miles from the Belgian coast through northern France to the Swiss Alps. When the mass of volunteers began to arrive from May 1915 onwards, the British army had suffered heavy losses. Much would now depend on the new battalions of volunteers.
We had no idea where we were going to. We're just on foot walking up to marching, as it were, laden right up with all our equipment, all you could carry, you know, everything on, and bent up with your guns, you've got everything on you. And suddenly you begin to see the sky lighting up, flashing, flashing, flashing. And you begin to hear the noise of the guns. You know, you're getting nearer. Fear and bewilderment were two words would describe it, definitely.
You went up the line wondering what it was like. Will I come back? You know, all these things went through your mind. Aye, I'll look after myself and I'll do, you know. But if the jury comes for me, I'll give him the bayonet. You know, all that went through your mind.
As they arrived at the front line, the volunteers discovered the harsh realities of trench life, an experience that has come to epitomize the Great War. It consisted largely of boring routine, lack of sleep, and utterly miserable conditions. For the fresh-faced youngsters, it was a huge shock. Robbie Burns had joined the Cameron Highlanders and was posted to the front line near Luz in France.
Of course, you get in the front line, the first thing you want to do is where are the Germans? You put your foot up in the fire step, which might be 18 inches or 2 feet up, and somebody said, sit down, you silly bee, you'll get shot. we still wanted to look over to see where the Germans were.
The first dose of trenches I had was St. Louis on the right of Ypres. It was supposed to be the cushy part of the line. But still, a lot of shit flew over the top just the same.
You got that noise all day long, day after day, day after day, for weeks. And the chaps used to all take turns on guard on the top of the trench for a couple hours, and then you go for a rest. You're to sleep more or less sitting up. You're sitting on what they call a fire step. You just sit on there and doze.
The army did its best to supply basic amenities for the men in the front line, even providing a regular postal service with home. But there were precious few comforts for the troops living on the bare earth.
You just had bins of bully and biscuits. You had to make do with those for the time being. They couldn't get food up to you for the time being, till you got to an open place where they used to bring up what they called a field kitchen. And then they supply with some hot soup.
I wrote a letter to Mum. I said, same old thing, bully beef and biscuits. So the officer came out to me and said, Dave, he said, what's this you've got on here? Bully beef and biscuits, he said. He said, can't you say you had roast beef and baked potatoes? And I said, I can't tell him, but I have an answer.
You never get a chance of a wash or a shave for several days. So you can just imagine the state we were in.
Such a gathering of unwashed male bodies provided a haven for lice.
The worst thing in the war was being so lousy you could burn, run along your with a candle with your shirt today and you'd be just as bad tomorrow. That was terrible. That was the worst thing of the lot.
The shared hardship helped foster a certain camaraderie and strengthened friendships amongst young men drawn together from all walks of civilian life.
We're all together for the first time. Where do you come from? What did you do? What did you work at? Any cigarettes? You got a light, you got a gasper. And they're all friendly. You married? No. Any girls? Oh, yes. Half a dozen. Yes. Yes, very friendly.
To help keep up morale and relieve tension, the army allowed the men to stage amateur shows behind the lines.
Someone lent me an old drum. It wasn't much good, but there was a drum and there was a couple of sticks to it. And I said, did they mind what I did with it? And so I got up there and I sang a St. Mayo number with the drum. And it was, behold in me, a one-man band that once was six, but down the strand we clicked for a bob and five got canged. Boom, boom, diddle-diddle-dum, dum-dum. So I have just come here to say everybody's got to live some way and the only tune that I can play is boom, boom, diddle-diddle-dum. And I bent on, there was about three verses to that one, till when I got to the end, I stuck the sticks right through the bloody drum. And of course, that caused roars of laughter at the back.
Across no man's land lay the German army, which launched sporadic raids. The British defences included the newly formed machine gun corps. The stalemate of trench warfare meant there was no place for the cavalry, and many of its men were transferred to machine gun teams. Smiler Marshall, who had been trained to charge the enemy on horseback, now had to learn to wait for the enemy to come to him.
The biggest thing of the lot, as the officer shouting, "Hold your fire." That's the worst thing of the lot. Hold your fire. You mustn't fire till he tells you. You've got to let them come on. That's the biggest shock of the lot. And I'll tell you, you get the wind up if a bit, because they're coming on and you're not allowed to fire. But of course, once you do fire, they scatter, don't they? I mean, you're doing what you should do. Your machine gun is, I mean, once you press that button, brrrr, in the distance, you just see them fall in and you don't know whether they're wounded or dead, because they're so far away.
Some of the volunteers were chosen to be snipers and sent out into no man's land to fire at the German trenches from close range. By August 1915, Jack Rogers was on sniping duty with the Sherwood Foresters.
They send one of our snipers out first thing in the morning, and there you'd lay all day long. You're afraid to move, as you'd be seen by the Germans looking out over this same spot of land. And if you see anything that's really worthwhile having a pot at, you used to have a shot or two. If your target is close enough, or your target is still enough, that you've got the time to think of where to shoot, I should probably shoot at the head.
The main action for which the volunteers had trained was to attack the enemy. Most had to face the ordeal of going over the top, the defining experience of the First World War. The aim was to advance across no man's land to capture the German trenches. As soon as they emerged, the men would face a hail of metal from machine guns and shells. Nineteen-year-old George Louth had been dreading this moment since he first arrived in France.
I'm like this, in the trench, with a cigarette, my last cigarette in my fingers, and I was like that. I don't mind telling you. That's how I was on my own, because we knew what we had to do. When we heard the whistle and the guns stopped, we're on the 7:30. We had to go. So the whistle went as the gun stopped, and away we went.
You get the word advance, and you advance. You might have to go this way because of the uneven ground, or that way. You just go forward the best you can. You're not on a parade ground when you're over the front. The parade ground, you've got to be so many inches away from each other. But when you're going over the top, you can't measure that. Some can run faster than the others.
When we got over the top, I lay down after running forward. Now, I could hear the whistle of the bullets going by, and I dropped down. If it hit me, I'd have been gone, but it didn't.
You just had to lie in the open air. Open air, there was no protection at all. And as flat as you could. Don't lift your head up when you're lying flat. Lie down as low as you could. And then when the shelling stopped, go forward a bit.
For the first 18 months of the war, the men only wore caps, making them especially vulnerable to head injuries from shrapnel. Robbie Burns' battalion of the Cameron Highlanders faced a severe onslaught during their attack at the Battle of Loos in September 1915. The battalion suffered a 90% casualty rate. This was the view that faced them.
As we went forward up, we could see the French 75, these were guns captured from the French in the early days of the war, and they were turned on us. We got so near that we could actually see the Germans putting shells into those guns, and the guns would fire almost straight at you. Bang, 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 bang. It's not the question of bang and away all of 2 or 3 miles, not only that, but those guns were bang, bang, just like that. And actually, they went more or less straight at you. More than once you could hear the whiz of a shell going past. Chappie on my right, I was speaking to him about something. And then I turned to this fellow. I turned back again. He was missing. One of those shells, straight at him. He was missing. Then I turned to this fellow on my left. I said, Bill's gone. And I turned to this fellow lying there. You're not allowed to stop and ask questions or find out this or find out that. And if one of your pals is wounded, you're not allowed to stop and help him. You're supposed to go right on.
On many occasions, friends who had enlisted and trained together went over the top together. George Littlefair's best friend from school days was Joe Coates, also a farm labourer.
The shell burst and it was shrapnel flying all over. I knew what had happened and down he went and groaned, and that was it. I had to get on because another wave was coming behind us. If I'd had time to do it, to lift his head up and try to talk to him, that's what I would have tried to do, but no good. He had to keep going. We had not even said so long to one another. Broken-hearted. That's the only way I can put it. Will it be me next? Aye. What did I join the army for? A young strand. Aye, to be see that shut down. Now that all went through my mind while I looked at that few seconds at Joe mourning, groaning before he died. Aye, poor Joe. What we were going to do, what was to do we were going to have when we got back out of the forces. Aye. You're a grand lad. We were a pair of good pals with Ed.
The men suffered horrendous wounds caused by shrapnel, shards of red-hot metal from exploding shells. The battlefields were littered with the dead, the dying and the injured. The stretcher-bearers of the Royal Army Medical Corps, the majority of whom were volunteers, followed immediately behind the advancing troops. It was their job to deal with this carnage. 19-year-old Dick Barron, with a knowledge of first aid learnt in the Boys' Life Brigade, served as a stretcher-bearer.
If you could do something, you could put them in a position where they weren't so awkward, position where they wouldn't be suffering so much. If blood was coming with pulses, you know, you felt, you knew that he'd had it. And all you could do was to put a dressing on. I mean, you weren't in an operating theatre. You've got to remember that you're in the field. It's bloody awful. If you ever carried a chap on a stretcher, I felt that my arms were coming out of their sockets. It's a chap gets very heavy, you know, to carry him very far on a stretcher.
But nothing could prepare Dick Barron for the ordeal of trying to care for his best friend.
One of the casualties I had to deal with was my own pal, Galley. I saw what he'd fell down and that he'd got it in the head. And I... sounds gruesome, but all I could do is to put the brain which had exuded through the wound back into the cranium. I had no good, of course, was it? But you don't behave normally in those conditions. You can't imagine to see your pal like that. You felt you'd got to do something. And that's what I did. But of course I knew when I came, considered the afterwards, I knew that he'd had it. I had been long in warfare where it lost all its romanticism. Warfare was a grim, unsatisfactory, bloody silly business.
Watching by the poplar, Colinette with the sea blue eyes. She is watching and longing and away.
After each attack, the advanced dressing stations on the edge of the battlefield were overwhelmed with casualties. With only rudimentary first aid available, the fight to save lives was often in vain. But the suffering and loss had to be faced with stoic endurance.
When you're in trouble, if you can start to sing, you're all right. When I got on, it's a long way to Tipperary, and take me back to dear old Blighty, and Mademoiselle and Armentiers. They'll join in all that. Take me back to dear old Blighty. Put me on the train for London town. Take me over there. Drop me anywhere. Birmingham, Leeds or Manchester. Well, I don't care. For I shall be off to see my best girl. Cuddling up together we soon shall be. Well... Hi-ti, tiddly-hi-ti, take me back to Blighty. Blighty is the place for me. See, that stop you from being mopey or worrying. You didn't worry if you were singing.
In the summer of 1916, there were high hopes of the big push, a breakthrough that would end the war. New waves of volunteer battalions, fresh from Britain, joined together with the battle-hardened troops already in France. They converged on the front line north of the River Somme. The army was so confident of a famous victory, censorship was relaxed, and the operation was filmed and photographed in detail. The first stage of the plan was to pound the German line for 7 days with the biggest artillery barrage of the war so far. The bombardment was directed along a 16-mile stretch of enemy trenches with, it seemed, devastating effect. On the eve of the attack, the assembled troops were assured the week's intensive bombardment had destroyed the German defenses. Such was the confidence of the commanding officers that there would be few Germans left alive. The whole pace of the assault was to be taken slowly. The infantry were to attack in successive waves of long, close-formed lines. This was to be the grandest of all set-piece trench assaults. Amongst those who prepared to go over the top was Arthur Wagstaff, formerly a London messenger boy. He is now 101.
Our instructions were that when you make the attack tomorrow morning, don't run. Walk across. We realized our bombardment would be knocking out those Germans in the front line. So hopefully, when we got there, there wouldn't be many there.
The preparations complete, the men were photographed in the trenches, grabbing some rest before their big day. At 7:30 a.m. on Saturday, the 1st of July, 1916, 120,000 men who had volunteered and trained for this moment were to go into battle. It was to be the first time over the top for 18-year-old Tommy Gay, a glassblower from London, now aged 100.
I was in one of the first to go over with the lads. And of course, we all had a tot of rum, shortly, to liven us up. And we all went over the top, find our little old one.
Now remember, our own company sergeant major sitting on the front of the trench and shouting, over the top, boys, over the top, but don't run, don't run. So we walked over there.
The bullets, they whizzed by my ears, you know, ping, 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 flying by my ears like that. And I thought, how marvellous, what's the matter that they've missed me? And yet the people were being killed. Oh, it was absolutely startling.
Then we looked along the line and we realised there were very few of us left. Some were left in the trench dead, some were dead on the way over. So we jumped into a very large shell hole, three or four of us, and stayed there for a minute or two because we could see that most of our chaps had been killed.
The men in this film were sheltering in a sunken road and about to go over the top to capture the village of Beaumont Hamel. It was hoped that this footage of soldiers preparing for battle would be a propaganda triumph for the British government. But within minutes, the men were dead, mown down by enemy machine gun fire. Fred Francis, now 104, was a miner in Carlisle before joining the 11th Borders, popularly known as the Lonsdale Battalion.
I can remember quite well on our right on the 1st of July with the Tyneside Scottish and the Tyneside Irish. When I filed out of the wood, the colonel patted me on the back and said, good luck, son. But unfortunately, they were just waiting for us. And they turned all the machine guns on us. And I got a bullet through the hip, and I dropped on my face. I put my steel helmet on the back of my head, and I could hear the shrapnel dropping on my steel helmet.
There were two or three companies left or right of us, and we couldn't see how they were doing, except that there seemed to be very few about. Very few were making the attack now. It was a disaster, really.
When the men arrived back at the advanced dressing stations, the full scale of the disaster began to sink in.
So many of our friends were missing and obviously had been killed or wounded.
I was so pleased to see other people that were still alive, I think that way. When you hear a fellow say, hello matey, give us a fag.
The final roll call revealed many thousands missing. The survivors struggled to understand what had happened to them and to their friends. Tommy Gay could not find his best friend.
From the time we went up over the top, went over together, I never saw his name was Johnny Jupp. Yes. And I never saw him anymore from going over the top with him. Must have had the bullet right away. Yeah. But not one of them had my name on. So I must have been the luckiest man on earth. But to walk over the front with all that machine gun fire and not one of those bullets got my name on it, I must be the luckiest man on earth. Absolutely the luckiest man in the world.
We realised that we were extremely lucky to have survived because it was a terrific slaughter. But this is why we joined the army. We have got to go forward. We have got to kill the Germans. And in the process, of course, we stand a rough chance of being killed ourselves. It is what we used to say, duty. That's the one word, duty. It's my duty to do this, and this is what I joined up to do, and I must do it.
The Lonsdale Battalion, who started the day with 750 men, suffered some of the worst casualties on the 1st of July. More than two-thirds of its men were killed or seriously injured. 22-year-old Fred Francis's wounds in the leg and the stomach were so bad, he was given the last rites. Remarkably, he recovered.
I feel very proud to have served in the Lonsdale Battalion, and I'll never cease to regret that after the 1st of July, the Lonsdale Battalion did not exist.
By the end of the day, 20,000 British troops had been killed and 40,000 wounded. It was the country's worst ever military disaster. The Battle of the Somme continued for a further 4.5 months. There were a few minor gains for the British, but at a terrible cost. 420,000 were killed or wounded. End of the Somme offensive, the Seaforth Highlanders were part of the successful taking of the village of Beaumont Hamel on the 13th of November 1916. After the battle, 19-year-old junior officer Norman Collins organized the burial of the dead.
I was told to bury, to collect the newly killed dead, which I did. I took it, it was stretcher bearers. Unfortunately, the stretcher bearers, a number of them, they were related to the ones who were dead. And some of them were their brothers, especially the Scottish regiment. We had such a lot of the same name, clan name, you see, MacLean. And they, of course, were very upset.
But also on the battlefield, were the old dead, the men killed when trying unsuccessfully to take Beaumont Hamel all those months before on the 1st of July. It had not been possible to bury these dead soldiers until the village had been captured.
The first one I saw, the first one I came across, with his hair growing out of his, still growing from his face. When I touched it, the rats ran out. There was nothing left under the putty except a bone. I just realized then, for me, what death was. A horrible form of death, too. You didn't know them men. They'd been dead for 4.5 months. They were strangers to you. You only knew them as young soldiers and officers who joined the war just as you had. They must have only been around about an average age of about 19 or 20. They'd come over there to do what they thought, no doubt, would be a wonderful job of work. And in one day they were destroyed. You thought then, and then you saw what happened with the rat's nest running out of the cage of the chest. Then you saw all that all happened. And you realized then what their aspirations, their ambitions, and what they were going to do. They were going to put the world right, and they were going to do this and that. And all they did was to die in a few minutes. Of course, they wouldn't know they were dead, you see. But for me, who saw what had happened, it seemed to me such a terrible waste of life.
Of the 2 million men who had volunteered to fight for their country in the first year of the war, 150,000 had been killed by November 1916. Their belief that war was a glorious adventure had been proved tragically wrong.
And you can see part two of Veterans at the later time of 10:30 next Sunday night on BBC One.
The 10th of November 1918, the Great War would come to an end. It had taken 10 million lives and shattered European civilization. The war changed everything.
The arms round his neck, they all knew, but half of them fell off. And the sergeant major shouted, "Who the hell told you to dismount?"
The biggest challenge for the civilian volunteers was army discipline. The training sergeants could be brutal in their demand for absolute obedience to authority. Humiliation was one of their weapons.
This particular sergeant, he got a nasty wagging tongue, and he used to call us all "you flippin' little mother's boys" and all that sort of talk, you know what I mean. And they always said they got one for him ready, they got a bullet ready for him any time that they get a chance, he'll have one up the spout. It was quite true too. I believe they would, in a sense, some of them. They so disliked this one particular sergeant.
Sometimes the humiliation proved too much for young men like George Littlefair, a farm labourer before joining up.
There was one little bugger, work stash, turned up, and yapping and shouting, "You're not only your mother's aprons now," and all that bloody tittle-tattle. And he used to call me Liquor Fair, because he was short-toned, he couldn't get Little Fair. And I was in one of them good humours, I never answered him. And so he come up and, "Timmer," he looked at him, "Who the hell do you think you are?" And I just stood. He said, "I think you're a bastard." Ooh, as soon as he said that, I hit him in the mouth with that. No, I said, "Don't prove it."
And he looked at me straight. Now, I was only 18. I put my age on, and he walked away. And from then on, it was all go.
The raw recruits had to be rapidly turned into soldiers ready for battle. They would be trained at hundreds of makeshift army camps that sprung up all over Britain.
You had to learn how to use a gun. You used to go on musketry courses. And so I got to be, as it happened, quite a good shot. And I became eventually what they called a marksman. And so for which I got an extra sixpence a day on my wages.
The cavalry was the army's elite attacking force, and its training methods were renowned for their toughness and precision. Many thousands of grooms and delivery boys who worked with horses enlisted, but they still had much to learn to make the grade. Smiler Marshall, a former groom in Wivenhoe, was just 17 when he joined the Essex Yeomanry. He is now 101.
When we went to the 20th Hussars at Colchester, you have to ride all different horses, nothing on them, no saddle, no bridle, no nothing. You have to have a stick and a little cane under each arm, and then when the riding masters cracked the whip, he didn't say anything. He just cracked the whip, and all the horses that you were on stopped dead. And you sure, if you didn't sit tight, I never come off. I sit there, but I put me.
The young men in these photographs volunteered to serve as soldiers at the beginning of the First World War. They left their factories, offices and farms to fight in the battles of the Somme and Passchendaele. Remarkably, they survived and have lived to be more than 100 years old. Some of their stories have not been told for over 80 years. This is their account of an event in British history now almost beyond living memory. They are the last survivors of the Great War, the veterans.
I went along this road, and the shell came along, and my goodness, it got louder and louder and louder, and I thought, my God, it's got my name on it.
One of the great big shells blew all the earth and the dirt straight on top of us. I couldn't move. I was terribly quickly breathing, gasping as it were, trying to get air in, of course. And it was only the fact that I'd got my steel hat on that saved my life.
Ah, you'd hear that bit of luck with you, else it's no damn good. Look and sense. No good saying, "Oh, I'm a British soldier, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that." You had to use your damn brains.
At 11 a.m. on a bank holiday Monday on the 4th of August 1914, Britons received the news that they were at war with Germany, a country with a vast army of trained reserves and conscripts. In contrast, Britain had only a small professional army, despite the size of its empire. As the British Expeditionary Force was rapidly dispatched to Belgium to meet the advancing enemy, the Secretary of State for War, Lord Kitchener, mounted a campaign throughout Britain to recruit 1 million volunteers. Amongst the first to volunteer in September 1914 was Dick Barron, a junior travel agent with Thomas Cook in London. He is now 103.
You can't imagine the war fever in those days, the patriotic war fever. I mean, we were at school told the thin red line. The soldiers were very, very spectacular creatures. And how they fought in the Crimea and the wonderful charge of the Light Brigade. It was all very romantic.
Robbie Burns grew up in the Scottish village of Gourock and was a 19-year-old clerk working in Glasgow. He is now 102.
Everywhere you went in Glasgow, the great big posters up of Kitchener and his finger pointing at you. No matter where you were, this finger seemed to be pointing at you. Your king and country need you. However, I worked in an insurance office and I went to the window. I could see probably 200 or 300 men. And the pipes always seemed to do something to rouse my enthusiasm. I thought to myself, well, I want to do something like this.
More than 500,000 men were recruited in the September and October of 1914. Another was Jack Rogers, an apprentice shoemaker in his father's business in Hammersmith. He is now 104.
So I was keen to go. I thought I'd like to be a soldier, you know, and do a bit of shooting. I was fancy being a rifleman, that was the point. And when I went up to Shepherd's Bush, which was the recruiting depot, they gave me then the choice of three different regiments I could have been in. The third one was the old Sherwood Foresters, 7th Battalion, and they were called the Robin Hood Rifles. So I fancied that. I thought, oh, I'd like to be a Robin Hood Rifle.
To enlist, volunteers had to be aged between 19 and 38. But such was the determination of younger boys to join up. Many lied about their age. Most recruiting officers turned a blind eye if the boys were strong and healthy. George Louth, a worker with the Portsmouth Gas and Coke Company, had lied about his age to get into the 15th Hampshire Regiment.
A colonel came round to visit us, to size us up, more or less, to see what we got. And he came round and asked questions. He said, and he asked each one how old they were and such like. So he came to me and asked me how old I was. I said, 19, sir. He said, 19? Yes, sir. Right. He went to the next man. He spoke to him. He come back to me again. He said, how old do you say you were? I said, 19, sir.